next passage.
Calorie.
So the term calorimetry stands here. The measurement of temperature. It means the measurement of temperature. Measurement of temperature. Now here we are using a device to measure the temperature is called as calorimeter. Calorimeter is a device used to measure the temperature. Okay. Now we can observe this device, calorimeter, where it consisting a vessel. Okay. Now this is a copper vessel with a stirrer. Okay. Stirrer. This is a stirrer here. Now both copper vessel and stirrer, they are of same material. And this particular copper vessel with the stirrer is fitted to a wooden box, or it is kept inside the wooden box. You can see that in the wooden box also there is another layer here where there is a gap between the wooden box with that of this calorimeter. That particular gap is filled with some non-conducting material, insulating material, so that the temperature of this particular calorimeter that should not exchange between system and surrounding. Okay, so that this particular non-conducting material is arranged between the wooden box, and the calorimeter. Okay, and there is a this particular system is fitted with a cover here, with a small rubber cork is also fitted here in order to fix the thermometer. Thermometer can be inserted inside this. Okay, so this is actually the total arrangement of the device called a calorimeter. Okay, it consists of a small vessel as well as a stirrer. Both are made up of by using same material and is kept inside the wooden box. Between wooden box and stirrer vessel, there is a small gap. The gap is filled by some non-conducting or insulating material. Okay. Now, the basic principle of this calorimeter. Heat lost by hot body is equal to heat gained by cold body. This is the basic principle of calorimeter. Heat lost by hot body is equal to heat gained by the cold body. That means when the temperature or heat energy, when it is transferring from hot body to cold body, there is no loss of heat energy takes place. Whatever the hot body loses its energy, that will be directly transferred to the cold body. In between, there is no loss of energy takes place. That we can express according to our relation. Heat loss or heat gain can be expressed in terms of delta Q, right? Delta Q is equal to Ms into delta T. Okay. For hot body, mass M1, specific heat S1, time gap is delta T1. Okay. M1, S1, delta T1 for the hot body. Okay. Mass of hot body, specific heat of material of the hot body and temperature loss. That means higher temperature minus lower temperature, delta T1. That is equal to heat gain. Heat gain is gained by the cold body. M2, S2, delta T2. Okay? M2, S2, delta T2. Where M2 is the mass of the cold body, S2 is the specific heat of the cold material, whereas delta T2 is the temperature difference. Okay? Now this can also be expressed as M1 plus 1, this delta T1 is T1 minus T, that is equal to M2 S2, this is T minus T2. So of course this is purely a difference here, okay? Higher temperature minus lower temperature. Here also, say after mixing this hot body with the cold body, the temperature of the cold body may increase from T to T2, okay? So therefore here this is the difference, delta T, okay? Yes, now you can also calculate the common temperature here. Yes, now let us see one problem here related to this particular concept of calorimetry or the principle of calorimetry. See that here, a sphere of aluminium of 0.47 kg. See that the mass of aluminium is given here, 0.047 kg plays for sufficient time in a vessel containing boiling water, so that the sphere is at 100 degrees Celsius, because we kept the sphere inside the boiling water. The temperature of the boiling water is of 100 degrees Celsius. This is the temperature. Okay. It is then immediately transferred to 0.14 kg of copper calorimeter. It is transferred into copper calorimeter. The mass of the copper calorimeter is 0.14 kg. Containing 0.25 kg of water. So inside the calorimeter, it is filled with the 0.25 kg of water. So here we can see that now at 20 degrees Celsius, temperature of the water is 20 degrees Celsius. Now we can observe one of the facts here. Initially we have an aluminium sphere, it is of 0.047 kg. It is kept inside the vessel and the temperature of the aluminium sphere is raised to 100 degrees Celsius. Then it is poured into the copper vessel of 0.14 kg, where it is filled by 0.25 kg of water. Therefore, the temperature of the aluminium sphere now transferred to this particular water as well as to the calorimeter, as well as to the copper calorimeter. So now we have to calculate. So that you see that after some time you can see that temperature of the water raises and attains steady state at 23 degrees Celsius. Just like initial temperature of the aluminium is 100 degrees Celsius, temperature of the water is 20 degrees Celsius. After pouring aluminium sphere into the calorimeter, so that the temperature of the water raises to 23 degrees Celsius. So now we have to calculate what is the specific heat capacity of aluminium. Now given that the specific heat of copper is 3860 joule per joule kg inverse Kelvin inverse. Okay? Now let us see how we can calculate the specific heat in this case. Okay? So the formula, as we know, that heat loss by aluminium. We know that heat lost by aluminium is equal to heat gained by water with the copper calorimeter. Water with the copper calorimeter. Okay. So heat lost by aluminium. That is M, mass of aluminium, specific heat of aluminium, M aluminium, specific heat of aluminium into delta T, delta T1, that is equal to heat gained by water with copper calorimeter. Now here, whatever the heat transferred from aluminium to copper vessel, where both water as well as copper vessel both are raises its temperature. Okay, so therefore mass of copper into specific heat of copper plus mass of water into specific heat of water into total temperature raise delta T2. Okay, now can calculate what is the specific heat of aluminium. Okay, yes, aluminium we have to calculate. So mass of aluminium is 0.047 kg into specific heat of aluminium into delta T. Delta T is change in temperature. The temperature of this changes from 100 degree Celsius to, it is added to 20 degree Celsius. So therefore, what is the change in temperature here? 100 minus 20. 100 minus 20, that is equal to 100 minus 20, that is 80, okay? 18, or you can write 100 minus 20, that is equal to mass of copper. Mass of copper vessel is, that is 0.14 kg of copper, 0.14 into specific heat of copper. Specific heat of copper is 3816 plus mass of water. Mass of water is 0.25 kg into specific heat of water. Then we know that specific heat of water already given, there is 4,200 into delta T2 is actually temperature raises from 20 to 23 degree Celsius. Okay, therefore raising temperature is 3 degree Celsius. Okay, into 3. So by simplification we can get specific heat of aluminium. Okay, so this is a simple mathematical calculation here that gives 0.91 into 10 to the power 3 joule kg inverse Kelvin inverse. Okay, so this is the, yes. Now coming to the next concept here, change of state. Okay, to explain this concept we have to consider the different states of matter. Okay, as you know that matter is existing three different states called solid state, liquid state and gaseous state. Okay, matter existing three states named as solid state, liquid state and gaseous state. Okay, gaseous states. Now we can change the state of matter from solid to liquid or liquid to gas, that is called as change of state. Okay, this is a transformation of state of a matter from one form to other, from solid to liquid or liquid to gas is called change of state. Okay, so now we have to explain this concept in detail. Now while we are transferring the state of a matter from one state to another state, what are the facts required? That means in order to change the state, we have to supply some amount of energy. Say in order to change the state from solid to liquid or liquid to gas, we have to supply some amount of energy. Okay, now while we are applying the energy, how these particular states will or matter will change from one state to another state, then I can explain by taking an example. So I can consider an ice cube, okay? Let an ice cube in a vessel. Okay? Consider ice cube in a vessel and apply some heat energy, okay? And apply some heat energy. Apply some heat energy. Let us see that what changes will take place here, that we can explain in terms of some graphical representation. Okay. Let us draw a graph of time along the x-axis, time in terms of minute along x-axis, or temperature in terms of degree Celsius along y-axis. I explain the concept of the transformation of state from solid to liquid and liquid to gas. Now initially we are applying some energy, heat energy to the ice cube. As we know that it takes certain instant of time to melt, okay, certain interval of time to melt. From 0 to a certain minutes, whatever the heat energy we have supplied, that will not increase the temperature of the system. Temperature will remain as it is, but what the heat energy we have supplied to the ice cube, that will be utilized to change the state of a matter from solid to liquid. So that from 0 to a certain instant of time, there is no change in temperature. That means at this stage, whatever the heat energy we have supplied, that is utilized to change the state of the matter. Now there is a temperature at which, the solid and liquid are coexist in thermal equilibrium is called as melting point of that particular solid. That is of course 0 degree Celsius. After that, okay, after that, if you increase the temperature, that means once the ice completely melts into water or liquid, then if you increase the if you apply the heat energy further, the temperature will raise. Okay, temperature raises. Now here there is a term called melting point. Melting point, okay. So melting point is actually here the temperature at which solid and liquid, okay, ice and liquid coexist in thermal equilibrium. Thermal equilibrium. This is at say 0 degree Celsius, okay. At this temperature, solid and liquid are coexist in thermal equilibrium is called melting point. Is called the melting point. Okay. This is the temperature at which ice and water are coexist in thermal equilibrium is called as melting point. Okay. Further, as time increases, temperature is also increases because we are supplying the heat energy continuously to the ice containing the vessel. Okay. Now, once again, once the temperature will reach us to some other value, say 100 degrees Celsius, 100 degrees Celsius, once again, there is a steady state here. Once again, there is a steady state. That means the temperature reaches to 100 degrees Celsius and stops it. Okay? That means even if you continuously apply some heat energy, there is no increment in temperature is observed. Now, here we can observe the liquid and the gas. This is the temperature at which liquid and gas coexist in thermal equilibrium, and this point is called as boiling point. It is called as boiling point. Okay. So this is another temperature. Okay. The temperature at which liquid and gas, liquid and gas coexist in thermal equilibrium. Thermal equilibrium. So this is at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, is called boiling point. Is called boiling point. Okay, is called boiling point. Effect of melting point, effect of pressure on melting point. Effect of pressure on melting point. Effect of pressure on melting point. That means if you increase the pressure, then what about the melting point? Okay. Now to explain this, we have to consider an ice cube. Okay. Consider an ice cube. Okay. Ice cube is kept in at a certain height. Ice cube is kept at a certain height. Okay. Now, let us consider two massive blocks. Okay, massive blocks are tied by means of a metallic thread, okay, and passes over this particular ice cube. Now you can say that two threads, okay, a thread is connected, the other end of this thread is connected to blocks, okay, two blocks of some masses, okay. Now you can see that here the metallic thread passes over the ice cube, where the two ends of the thread is connected by two blocks having certain mass. We can observe one of the fact here. Below this particular wire, the wire which is in contact with the ice cube, where the pressure is increases because of this weight, okay, as pressure increases, the ice will start to melt. Then we can observe one of the phenomena here, that this particular wire will goes on moves through this particular ice cube without breaking the ice. That means here the lower portion of this wire, now that we have ice, that will be goes on melts due to high pressure, whereas the upper portion of the wire, that is at low pressure, where that particular ice, the water is again converted into ice, fuses, okay. So that after sometimes you can observe the wire will come somewhere here, okay, and finally that wire will be passes through this particular cube without breaking this particular cube. This is a theorem. As pressure increases, the ice will melt here, okay, ice will melt. The same phenomenon we can observe in case of skating also, okay. Now normally the skating is very easy in ice or snow, okay. If you kept the case skating and if you stand on the skating, now what about the pressure below the skating and in contact with the ice, that will be increases. As a result, that particular area, the ice will easily melts because of high pressure. Okay, so this is one of the concept here, the effect of pressure on melting points. Let us see another concept here, effect of pressure on boiling point. We discussed about effect of pressure on melting point. As temperature increases, pressure increases, therefore the ice will melt easily. Okay, now let us see another concept here, effect of pressure on boiling point. Now to explain this, let us consider a round bottom glass filled with some water, fitted with a thermometer and a steam outlet by means of a burner, we can apply some heat energy to this particular water taken in a flask. Okay. So now, as the temperature increases here, or if you apply some heat energy continuously, water will start to boil. So that the temperature of the water is increases. Okay, at 100 degrees Celsius, it will start to boil, and then the steam will be comes out. Okay. Now let us see some experiment here. You just close this steam outlet. Okay. If you just close this steam outlet, now what happened? Inside the bottom, round bottom flask, the pressure increases. Now, before that, before closing, once the temperature reaches to 100 degrees Celsius, whatever the water present here, it will be start to boil. Okay. But if you close this particular steam outlet, automatically the boiling will stops. Boiling will stops. That means in order to boil the water, it requires still more energy. We have to supply some more energy to this particular system in order to boil the water. If you open this at 100 degrees Celsius, it will be boils. Or if you close this, the boiling will immediately stops. That shows here, as pressure increases, what is the effect of pressure? As pressure increases, boiling point of water is also increases. As pressure increases, boiling point of water is also increases. Then what is the advantage of this? You can see that in cooker, pressure cooker. We can see that in pressure cooker. Okay? When pressure cooker, the cooking material will boil immediately as compared to that of the open vessel. Why the cooking material boils immediately? The reason here, you can see that in a pressure cooker, pressure increases. As pressure increases, boiling point increases, then immediately the material will boil. So that is what the application here, the effect of pressure on boiling point. Okay? Further, we can also observe another point here. Suppose if you completely remove this thermometer and steam outlet, and if you fix some cord with airtight cord to this particular round bottom glass, and if you add some cold water over this particular round bottom glass, as a result we can observe one more fact. Okay. Before adding the cold water, let us reduce the temperature of this particular water. Say initially it was 100 degrees Celsius. Now let us decrease the temperature of the cold water from 180 degrees Celsius. After that we remove the thermometer as well as steam outlet and fix with some airtight cord and add some ice cold water to the round bottom flask outside. Okay. Not inside, outside. Paragadi now add water, ice cold water, no? Now if you observe, the water inside this particular flask, it is found that whatever the water present inside, we start to boil. Water inside the round bottom flask start to boil. That means as temperature, as pressure decreases, boiling point of this water decreases. The effect here is, As pressure increases, boiling point of water increases. Boiling point of water increases. Or as pressure decreases, boiling point of water decreases. So that's why you can see that one more fact here. That in the high altitude places, okay? High altitude places, where cooking is somewhat difficult.
ಸೀ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಇದ್ರಿಂದ ತುಂಬಾ ಹೈಟ್ಗೆ ಹೋದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕುಕ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಮೆಟೀರಿಯಲ್ ಕುಕ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ತುಂಬಾ ಕಷ್ಟ. ದ ರೀಸನ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಸ್ ದಿ ಹೈಟ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಅಸ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಅಟ್ಮೋಸ್ಫಿಯರಿಕ್ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸಸ್. ಅಟ್ಮೋಸ್ಫಿಯರಿಕ್ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆದ್ರೆ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆದ್ರೆ ಬಾಯ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ವಾಟರ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸಸ್. ಬಾಯ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆದ್ರೆ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿಫಿಕಲ್ಟ್ ಟು ಕುಕ್ ಎ ಮೆಟೀರಿಯಲ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ನಾರ್ಮಲಿ ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆಲ್ ಮೆಟೀರಿಯಲ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಾಯ್ಲ್ಸ್ ಅಟ್ ಆರ್ ಕುಕ್ಸ್ ಅಟ್ 100 ಡಿಗ್ರಿ ಸೆಲ್ಸಿಯಸ್. ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಬಾಯ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಬಾಯ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಟರ್. ಓಕೆ, ಬಟ್ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆದ್ರೆ ಬಾಯ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಸಪೋಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸಸ್ ಟು ಸಮ್ ಔಟ್ 80 ಡಿಗ್ರಿ ಸೆಲ್ಸಿಯಸ್ ಆರ್ 70 ಡಿಗ್ರಿ ಸೆಲ್ಸಿಯಸ್ ಅಟ್ ದಟ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ದ ಮೆಟೀರಿಯಲ್ ವಿಲ್ ನಾಟ್ ಕುಕ್ಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಅನದರ್ ಕಾನ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ ರಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಇಫೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಆನ್ ಬಾಯ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಟರ್. ಓಕೆ, latent heat, latent heat expressed as capital L. Now the term say latent heat stands here, it is the amount of heat required to change the state of the matter from one state to another state is called as latent heat. Okay, amount of heat required to change the state, change the state of a matter, state of a matter, amount of heat required to change, amount of heat required to change the state, change the state of a matter is called latent heat, latent heat. So amount of heat required normally you can express delta Q. Delta Q is equal to heat required to change the state. Q is equal to latent heat, or you can express L. L is equal to Q by heat required to change the state of the matter. Okay. M, L by L, okay? L is equal to Q by L, okay? Or Q is equal to L into M, M into L or L into L, okay? So here, we can also define this latent heat by using this idea. It is actually the quantity of heat required to change the state of unit mass of a substance, okay? Is called as latent heat. That is normally expressed in terms of L is equal to Q by M or Q is equal to M into L. Q stands for the quantity of heat required, Q is equal to M into L. So it is the amount, say here as we discussed that in order to change the state of a matter from solid to liquid, we are applying some heat energy. By that case, we are applying how much amount of heat energy, that Q is equal to L into M. Now, from solid to liquid or from liquid to gaseous state, it can be expressed as latent heat. Latent heat of vaporization and latent heat of fusion. Okay, latent heat of fusion. Latent heat of fusion. So this is a quantity of heat required to change the state of a matter from solid to liquid. Okay, quantity of heat required to change the state of a matter, from solid to liquid. So that can express in terms of latent heat of fusion is LF is equal to Q by M. Okay, LF is equal to Q by M, latent heat of fusion. Whereas latent heat of vaporization,
latent heat of vaporization, it is LV. LV, okay.
So this is a quantity of heat required to change the state of a matter from liquid to gaseous state. Okay, quantity of heat required. Quantity of heat required to change the state of matter from liquid to gas.
Yes, a latent heat of vaporization, that is expressed in terms of LV is equal to Q by M. Okay, Q by M.
Now the value of this LF and LV for 1 kg of water, we can express for
1 kg of water. For 1 kg of water, the value of LF is actually the latent heat of fusion for 1 kg of water is 3.36 into 10 to the power 5 joule per kg.
3.36 into 10 to the power 5 joule per kg. Whereas LV is
equal to, it is 22.6 into 10 to the power 5 joule per kg. 10 to the power 5 joule per kg. Okay.
So this is the value of LF and LV for 1 kg of water. Okay. Then quantity of heat, whatever we have supplied, that is known. And what is the amount of substance what we have considered, that is also known. Okay. So this is the concept of latent heat. Now using all these ideas, we can discuss a heating curve.
Heating curve. Heating curve. Now suppose if we draw a graph of temperature along y-axis versus the heat energy whatever we are supplied. Okay, heat energy whatever we are supplied. Now we can draw a graph here. Now from initially we are supplying some heat energy so that the solid will start to melt. Okay, until solid completely melts ice to water, the temperature will not raises. After that the temperature will start to raise. Okay, the graph we can express here, say this is 0 to some temperature A, where there is increase in temperature takes place here, increase in temperature takes place, but the state will be same. Now here melting will start, okay. This is somewhat say 0 degree Celsius, okay. Once it reaches to 0 degree Celsius, the ice will start to melt. So it takes certain instant of time. Up to there, we have to supply some amount of heat energy. After that, once ice completely melts, again temperature raises A to B, B to C. Further, it will reach some temperature, say 100 degree Celsius here. 100 degree Celsius. After that, again, it is a certain instant of time we are applying some heat energy. So that there is no change in temperature takes place here. And further, once water completely converts into vapor, then its temperature is again increases. Okay? C to A. B, C, C to D,
into P.
Yes.
In the region, OA, you see that what changes will take place from O to A? Where we are applying some heat energy continuously, so that the temperature is increases from up to 0 degree Celsius, okay, increases up to 0 degree Celsius. Therefore, what is the quantity of heat supplied? Delta Q is equal to M S into delta T. M S into delta T. Now, when S is the specific heat of ice, here S stands for S is the specific heat of ice. Here we have to use the concept that S is the specific heat of ice. Okay? Then in region A to B, where there is no change in temperature takes place, but we are applying some heat energy. In this case, delta Q is expressed in terms of M into L, latent heat of fusion, okay? Because here, change in state will take place, okay? From B to C, in region B to C, again there is a change in temperature. Therefore, delta Q is equal to M into S into delta T, but here it is a liquid state, therefore S stands for here specific heat of liquid, specific heat of water. Okay, again the region B, C, C to D. In region C to D, where delta T is equal to once again M into LV, where fusion will take place, where LV stands for latent heat of fusion. Okay, and from D to E, in region DE, once again delta Q is equal to M into S into delta D, where S stands for specific heat of gas. S is the specific heat of gas. Okay? So these are the different changes what takes place in this graph. Okay? Yes, let us come to one problem. When 0.15 kg of ice at 0 degree Celsius mixed with the 0.30 kg of water at 50 degree Celsius in a container, the resulting temperature is 6.7 degree Celsius. Calculate heat of fusion of ice, LV, okay, LF, heat of fusion, okay, LF we have to calculate. Now the situation here is, ice is at 0 degree Celsius and water is at 50 degree Celsius. Therefore, if you mix water at 50 degree Celsius to ice at 0 degree Celsius, the water loses its energy, whereas the ice will gain the energy. Okay? Now we can calculate what is the heat lost by water. Heat lost by water first, okay? Heat lost by water is equal to the basic formula, as you know, that Ms into delta T, where M stands for mass of water, specific heat of water into change in temperature. So change in temperature, so mass of water is how much? It is given that 0.30 kg of mass of water, specific heat of water is 4186. Into the temperature change takes place from 50 degree Celsius to 6.7 degree Celsius. Okay, so therefore 50 minus 6.7 degree Celsius, that will be gives the value of heat lost by water. By mathematical simplification, it gives 54,376 joule. 376 joule, this we can calculate, okay? Now, water will lose its energy, water at 50 degree Celsius loses its energy, that energy is transferred to ice at 0 degree Celsius, so that ice will start to melt, okay? Now, a small portion of energy, whatever we have transferred, that is used to convert ice at 0 degree Celsius to water at 0 degree Celsius. Okay? A small portion of energy, that is heat required to change the phase. Okay? Heat required to change the phase. Heat required to change the phase. That is equal to Q is equal to mass of ice into latent heat of fusion. Okay? Latent heat of fusion. That LF we have to calculate. Okay? That mass of ice is from here, that is 0.15 kg. Okay? Then, further, remaining amount of energy that is used to increase the temperature from water at 0 degree Celsius to water at 6.7 degree Celsius. Okay? That is heat required to raise the temperature. Required to raise the temperature. That is m mass of, now here we have to consider ice will melt into water. Therefore, mass of ice we have to consider. Mass of ice. But now it is already converted from ice to water. Therefore, we have to consider the specific heat of water into delta T. So here mass of ice is 0.15. Specific heat of water is 4186. The temperature change from 0 to 6.7 degree Celsius. Therefore, change in temperature is 6.7. Okay? So if you simplify the 0.15 into 4186 into 6.7, it gives about 4206.9 joule. Okay? 4206.9 joule. Now, to calculate this latent heat of fusion, we have to use the principle of calorimeter, that heat lost by the hot body is equal to heat gained. Heat lost by the hot body. Heat lost by hot body is equal to heat gain by cold body. Heat gained by cold body, okay? Cold body. So here heat lost by hot body is this one, 54,376. That is the heat gained by the cold bodies. That is mass of ice is 0.15 into latent heat of fusion plus this one, 4206.9. Now by mathematical calculation you can calculate what is the latent heat of fusion LF. Okay. That by calculation gives 3.34 into 10 to the power 5 joule per kg. Okay. So this is the value of latent heat of fusion. Okay. So you can also come to the similar topic here. Calculate the heat required to convert 3 kg of ice at minus 12 degree Celsius kept in a calorimeter to steam at 100 degree Celsius at atmospheric pressure, given the value of latent heat of fusion as well as latent heat of vaporization. Now, since situation in this problem, initially ice is at minus 12 degree Celsius. Now, first we have to increase the temperature of the ice from minus 12 degree Celsius to 0 degree Celsius. After that, we have to change the state of ice. That means ice at 0 degree Celsius to ice at water at 0 degree Celsius. Okay? Ice at 0 degree Celsius to water at 0 degree Celsius. Then we have to increase the temperature of water from 0 degree Celsius to 100 degree Celsius. After that, we have to convert from water at 100 degree Celsius to steam at 100 degree Celsius. That means once again we have to change the phase. So for all these processes we require some amount of energy. That energy we have to calculate. Okay. So then we can add all these things. It will reduce to what is the total energy required to convert ice at minus 12 degrees Celsius to water or steam at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. Let us first come to the point here. Heat required to raise the temperature. Heat required to raise the temperature from minus 12 degrees Celsius to 0 degrees Celsius. Okay, that is Q1. Now, ice at minus 12 degrees Celsius to ice at 0 degrees Celsius. For that, we require some amount of energy here. That energy Q1 is equal to mass of ice into specific heat of ice into changing temperature. Mass of ice into specific heat of ice into changing temperature. Mass of ice, 3 kg of ice into specific heat of ice. As we know that the specific heat of water is 4186, whereas ice is exactly half of that, somewhat 2100. Okay, ice 2100 into changing temperature. Changing temperature is from minus 12 degrees Celsius to 0 degrees Celsius. Therefore, changing temperature is 12. Okay, so this we can simplify. 3 into 2100 into 12, it gives 75,600. 75,600 joule. Okay. Then, now the temperature of the ice is increasing from minus 12 to 0 degrees Celsius. Further, we have to change the state from ice at 0 degrees Celsius to ice at water. Ice at 0 degrees Celsius to water at 0 degrees Celsius. Okay. So, heat required to change the state. Heat required to change the state, that is ice at 0 degrees Celsius to water at 0 degrees Celsius. Water at 0 degrees Celsius is, that is Q2 is equal to, now here we have to use the idea of latent heat of fusion, that is M into L, mass of ice into latent heat of fusion. Okay, latent heat of fusion. What is the mass of ice now? 3 kg into latent heat of fusion is given as 3.35 into 10 to the power 5 joule per kg. On simplification, it gives about 10,05,000. Okay, 10,05 joule. Okay. 10,05,000 joule. Then you can simplify. Okay. Further, now we have to supply some heat energy to raise the temperature of water from 0 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. Heat required to raise the temperature from 0 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius, that is Q3 is equal to mass of water, specific heat of water into delta T. Now water is equal, here ice melts into water, therefore the mass will be remain same. So mass of water is 3, specific heat of water is 4186 into changing temperature is 100. Okay. Mass of water, specific heat of water into changing temperature is 100, gives 12,55,800 joule. Okay. Then we converted from ice to water and water to steam now. Once again, now water is at 100 degrees Celsius now. Now we have to convert water at 100 degrees Celsius to steam at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now heat required to change the state. Heat required to change the state. Water to steam. Water to steam. Okay. Steam. That is Q4.
that Q4 is equal to m into LV. Okay, that is mass of water into LV. Okay,
let us get of vaporization. Mass of water, mass of ice, here we will say. Therefore, 3 into latent heat of vaporization is given 22.5 into 10 raised to 5.
If we can simplify here, it gives 67,68,000 joule. Okay? So that is Q4. Now let us find what is the total heat required to convert ice at minus 12 degrees Celsius to steam at 100 degrees Celsius. That is total energy Q. Therefore, Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 plus Q4. So let us add all the values here, okay? Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 plus Q4. If we add all the values of energy here, that gives 9.1 into 10 to the power 6. 9.1 into 10 to the power 6 joule. This is the energy required, okay? Energy required to convert ice at minus 12 degrees Celsius to steam at 100 degrees Celsius, okay? So, like it, we can solve the problems by using the idea of principle of calorimeter, okay?